business leaders, CEOs, face a very difficult challenge in a world that has become heavily political. Business management techniques evolved in a world that was roughly, largely private. At the end of the 19th century, government was at less than 5% of the economy. Now it approaches 50%. During that largely private era, the business community learned many techniques, but it's failed to apply those techniques to its political operations. When you look at the business world, it has to solve the problem of ensuring that its sub-agents operate in the interest of the company as a whole. The CEO, as the principal, has to ensure that his agents, his subgroups within his organization, are also operating in a way that is consistent with the overall profitability of the firm. The classic example of that is in the private world, where the business will have one unit that markets, sells its products, and another unit that makes its products, the production unit. The production unit is concerned about cost, efficiency, and naturally believes that you maximize that process by minimizing the amount of setups. The longer the consistent runs you can have, the better your operations are. Their operational goal, one product, black, 24/7, 360 days of the year. A reasonable objective for them. The marketing department, trying to maximize sales, has a very different objective. Many, many products, different colors, different shapes, different sizes, because their goal is to meet the diverse needs of the diverse consumer population. Very reasonable process also. But one product and a myriad of products are both the wrong answer for the overall profitability of the company. And the CEO's challenge and his responsibility is to create restrictions, mandates, incentive structures, and requirements that they get together and negotiate to ensure that the compromise that emerges is compatible with the overall profits of the firm. The principal agent problem, as this situation is called, has been solved, taught in business schools, and is part of very good management strategy by all CEOs. But with a world that is now 50% of the economy, agencies have also grown up within the modern corporation dealing with political issues. The government affairs department, the public affairs department, the philanthropy office, community affairs groups. And all of those groups have their own incentives, just as does the production and marketing department. And the CEO of today has spent too little time thinking through how to ensure that their operations are compatible with the long-term profitability of the firm. An example with the government affairs department. You're picking someone to be your government representative in Washington. It's a very big responsibility. You naturally think about expertise. You go to Congress, you go to the administration, you go to policy groups that have been working in Washington and know the Washington game. But those people will know very little about how their decisions affect the overall long-term profitability of the firm, in part because the time scale of politics is very, very short, hours, days, months at most, whereas corporations make investment decisions that may go 5 or 10 years. A decision in Washington which raises the difficulty of innovation, which makes it harder to restructure your business, which makes it harder for you to change your employment structure, your work rules, can have devastating effect on the long-term ability of the firm to become and to maintain profitability. The CEO has to ensure that his agent, the government affairs guy, understands the trade-offs between the short-term goals of the wealth redistribution nature of Washington and the long-term wealth creation goals of the corporation through profitability. Too often, the businessman doesn't do that. And he should also be aware that Washington is a very tempting place, as all minor, of all specialized environments are. The government rep lives in Washington, works in Washington, associates with his fellow businessmen, all who are imbued with the same lack of knowledge of the value of capitalism. Those people too often will have an ethos of, you've got to go along to get along. It would be foolish to fight City Hall. You know, you can't just say no. We don't believe in being negative on the proposals of the senator, the congressman, the president, because that would just create enemies, and you've got to make friends in this city. Well, you have to sometime recognize that opposition to policies that will hurt your company are important because that's what you're paid to do, to be the agent of the company in this hostile, often hostile, environment of politics. And to do that, you have to understand and be willing to do what's good for your company, not what makes your cocktail lunches a little more favorable today. Because you're not representing Washington to the business, you should be repping the business to Washington. But that, of course, is only, that will only happen if the CEO takes his principal responsibilities to monitor and incentivize his agents. That challenge is poorly met in Washington today. Business has been spending vastly greater sums in Washington over the last decades, and yet government has grown and grown and grown. It has grown largely because business has accepted the appeasement, apologetic attitude of Washington, represented to them by their government affairs guys, rather than demanding that their government affairs guys stand up for the moral value of capitalism. That story, of course, is not new. It was told in the novel Atlas Shrugged by Ayn Rand, where she had her great businessman, Hank Reardon, an individual who took his responsibilities as CEOs to manage the principal agent problem in his private sector extremely seriously. Every foreman in that plant was picked by him to be the person to ideally represent the company's overall objectives of producing quality metals at affordable prices. No one in that firm was left to do their own thing or to act in ways that were counterproductive to the customers, the company. But he hires who? Wesley Mouch to be his representative in Washington, D.C. Why? Well, politics is there. You have to have someone to represent you in politics. But then he says, I don't know politics, I don't like politics, and I don't want to know politics. I leave it all to my Washington rep. He abandons his responsibility as a CEO and leaves his company in Washington, in the political world, in the hands of a person who knows nothing about capitalism, has absolute disdain for the moral values of a free society. That individual receives checks. Reardon proudly says, I signed the checks. Those checks are used to undermine the company's long-term profitability, to eventually create government programs that destroy the company, Reardon Metals, and eventually puts it out of business. Business in a lesser way is paying for its own destruction when it could be mounting the moral defense, both directly and by having its government affairs directors move out and find the allies who also understand the value of capitalism and together fight back and recover some of the territory that the failure of business to take politics seriously has resulted in for the last century.